Hello and welcome to the Django DRF project, eCommerce. This tutorial is part of a series of tutorials which you can watch for free. The link to the YouTube course playlist is in the video description. This course is also available on Udemy, where you can watch the course ad-free, download the tutorial source code, and access all updated tutorials and playlist. The link to the course, which will always provide the best price, can be found in the video description. Now that we have defined our view set, let's go ahead now and finish this process and build our router. So, like I said previously, what's going to happen here is our client, the front end, is going to send a request to our API. Our router here is going to look and inspect that information and try and match it to maybe a resource that exists within our Django application, and then send it over to that resource, which is our view set. And then that data then can, or that request can then be processed. Right. So we're going to just close all this up. Let's close everything up. Right. So in our DRF commerce, and we're going to be in the DRF commerce, in a DRF commerce here, we have our URLs. So this is where we're going to define the patterns that can be matched against requests. So we already have one pattern here, URL pattern. That's the path to the admin site. So let's go ahead and now add a new path. So we want to be able to capture, let's go for API. So we're going to have this prefix to our API, which is just API slash. And now what we're going to do is we're going to build a router, which is a way of automating the process of defining each path. Now, take for example, think about all the different operations that we can perform on data: create, return, update, and delete. So each one of those is an individual request, or it could be an individual request. Each one of those requests potentially requires its own path. So we could manually type out all of these paths, or alternatively, we could utilize a router, which would automatically create the paths for us based upon the information that's supplied within our code. So for example, a view set, let's go into our view set. The point here of utilizing a view set is our router can have a look or utilize the information in the view set to determine what paths need to be created. And depending on what type of view sets we use as well, can also then depend on what paths are created by the router. Now, that probably needs a little bit more reading in the DRF documentation to fully understand, but let's have a go at having a look at some of the different settings by building our router. Okay, so back in the URLs, let's go ahead now and we're just going to define an include here. So include, and then that's going to be the router.urls. So, that's completely ruined that. So include router.urls. Okay, I think we're good there. Path include. Yeah, okay. So with that in place, apologies about that. Let's go ahead and we'll sort that out shortly. So let's go ahead and now import include. So we are going to need include tool, so we can do that. And now let's set out and build our router. Right, so from the REST framework dot routers, let's go ahead and import the default router. That's the first thing that we need to do. And then let's set up our router, or create an instance of our router. Router equals default router. Okay, so we create an instance of our router here, and then we can go ahead and start to actually register a router.register some new paths. So here then, let's go for category, and then we just need to define and hook it up to our view. So views.category view set. There we go. So we're going to need to bring this view set in to kind of hook this all up. So from DRF commerce.product, let's import the views. There we go. Okay. So what we've done here is we've created a new router, and then we've registered and utilized the information, or the router's going to utilize the information within our category view set to actually then build the endpoints that we need. And you can see here that that's then going to be accessible via API slash, and then it's going to then include all the router URLs that have been generated. So at this point, we're probably going to need to see this in action, right? So let's go ahead and, for us to understand fully, let's do the other way around. So let's go ahead and run the server. Now you can see here that we have an error. So this is just a syntax error, looks like we've got going on here. Views.category has no attribute category view set. So I've probably just named that wrong. Category view. That's why we called it category view, not category view set. So let me just change that to category view set. There we go. Right. So default router object has no attribute ULS. Well, of course it doesn't. So let's change that. So where is that? That is in line 10. So we're told here it's line 10 here. So URLs. Okay, and now you can see everything is working nicely. So it can be a very beautiful framework to work with and language to work with. You saw there how easy it was to kind of debug. Over time, you train your eyes to kind of zoom into straight where it needs to be, where you need to be looking at. I was able to look at the line. There was an error, and I was able to get to that error very quickly. So now when you navigate to the address that your server defines, so 127.0.0.1.8000. If you're not too sure, have a look at the terminal. It tells you. You can see that we have now two paths, or two URL patterns, admin and API. So let's go ahead and go /API. There we go. And there we have our first endpoint here. So notice that what we have here is an endpoint. So for category, this is the endpoint here. So what I can do is I can click on this. So this has been automatically generated by our default router. And there we go. So at the moment, it says no such category, product category at the moment. So there's clearly an error here in our code. Maybe we haven't migrated, but that's an interesting one. So no such table, product category. Okay. So in my case, I've simply just forgotten to migrate all the tables again. So let's just go ahead and do that if you have been following step by step and you haven't done that. So make migrations. Let's do that. And let's go ahead now and migrate. So I just go ahead and migrate everything. So we should have some tables now. So let's go back into the web page. Let's go ahead and refresh again. And there we go. We've forgotten to turn the server on. So remember, there's a history. So I just press up and down on the keyboard until I get to the command, which is fairly close because I've used it quite recently. So that's manage.py run server. Just bring the screen up a little bit so you can see the actual command. It was a little bit cut off. Okay, so back to the browser. Let's press refresh. And it's still not working. It's because I didn't actually start the server. Okay, now I'm starting the server. Okay, so this time, refresh. And there we go. So we haven't returned any data. This is where the data is going to appear. So we don't actually have any data yet. So we know what to do now. We need to add some data now into our database. Right, so let's go back to our application and let's go into the admin. And we're just going to register the admin, from .models. Let's just go ahead and just register for now the tables that we have built. So that was category and product, right? And then let's go ahead and just register them to the admin panel. So admin.site.register. And then let's just go for product. And then we can just do the same thing for the other tables. We'll make some changes later on, but just for now, so that we can start to utilize them, let's go ahead and just register them. So this just basically registers the three models that we created so that we can access them in the Django admin. Now, what I'm going to do is press Control C to close the server, clear it up, and now I'm going to type in manage.py and then create super user, because I can't access the admin yet unless I add a new super user. So create super user, and then let's type in admin for a username, no email address, so just press enter, and then you can't see the password. It doesn't appear, but you are typing it in. So admin, admin, and there we go. Right, so obviously I don't recommend that moving forward, but we have a username of admin and a password of admin. So let's turn on the server. Let's go back. If you remember, the path is the root and then at the end, admin. So that's the path we need. So 127.0.1:8000/admin. Right, so type in admin, admin. That's a username and password. Not now. And there we go. So we have our three tables here. So we need to be careful how we enter the table data, remember, because we can't add a product unless there's a category. Because remember, we've created a foreign key, although it is null. Good point there. So that doesn't really matter at this point, but it's going to be the same for brands because we made a foreign key to brands. So we won't be able to make a product unless there is a brand. So let's just try it out. I don't think we set that to null. So you can see there isn't a brand here and there isn't a category. So if I try and press save, you can see that a field is required. And that's the constraints that we built when we developed the tables in our database. I think you could read through this in terms of referential integrity. So regardless of that, let's go back into categories. Right, let's add a category here. Let's just call this cat1, and there's no parent. Okay, so we don't need to worry about a parent yet. So let's go for cat1. Let's press out. Let's call this level1. Or let's just call it cat1. Okay, I'm overthinking this. Cat1, press save. Right, so let's go back now into our API. Now, you might want to open up a separate window for this. I'm just going to get straight in. So go back to our API. You can see the link to the category, to view all the categories. Click on that, and you can now see that we've returned all the data. So you can see that there are a number of different fields here that you might not be familiar with because we didn't actually add them in. And like I referred to earlier, because we're using MPTT, it does add some additional fields, which is required in order to build the structures that it creates. We can ignore it. It doesn't make any difference at this point. But you can see here that we've added the fields ourselves, the name, for example, and that's cat1. So if you're not familiar with this kind of client front-end setups scenario, if you imagine that this now has made a request from a front end, which we're kind of simulating here in this Django REST framework interface, we're able to make a request, and that is making a request to our API. Now our API is working in a way that the request is being matched against the URL. Okay. Then that is then connected to our view set. Our view set is then processing that request. Now remember, within our view set, we have requested for us to get all the data from the category table, and then we're sending that back, but we're passing that through our serializer, which is then preparing our data then to be sent back. And this is the actual data that's being sent back here in this kind of JSON format. So another thing to understand at this point is we're sending a GET request. So we're sending a GET request. And so it's important to understand the idea and concepts of different types of requests that we can send from a front end. So in this situation here, we're sending a GET request because we want to get data from the database, for example. So this was the view set that we've created. We created a view set, and you'll notice that the view set, so this is from the Django DRF documentation, is connected to a certain amount of actions. So within our view set, we create a new view set, and you can see here there are a number of different actions. Depending on how we want our data, how we want the client to interact with our data, will depend on what functions we define here, what methods we define. Now we have defined the list function, which, as it suggests, allows us to return a list of data back to the front end. Now, if we wanted to, for example, pass data from the front end and actually wanted to add it to the database, well, we would use a different function here, for example, which could do that. If we wanted to delete data or whether we wanted to update data. So you can see that we have different functions here for different features or for different actions that we want the actual client to be able to perform within our system or on our data. This will become clearer once we start to use more of the functionality, of course. But just to kind of get the ball rolling, if you like, just to kind of try and plant that information in your mind so that we can work on it later in the project. At this point, we've now created our serializer, a view set, and the routing for the category table, at least a basic interaction with the category table. So we need to now perform the same type of function, or the same process, if you like, with the product and brand and all the other tables here in our database. Now, of course, our interactions for each table will be slightly different. So there will be some differences and some other challenges that we're going to need to implement. But essentially, we have now been through the process of the first iteration, if you like, of what we're going to now replicate for the rest of the database.